Good afternoon, sir. Thank you for connecting with the forensic corner. And we really appreciate that you could take out your time for this interview. And thank you so much for connecting with us, sir. And sir, I, Prashant Singh, with my colleague, Nandini Gupta, we welcome you for today's interview. And we are graduate students of forensic science from M.Sc. University, Haryana. And we have also a keen interest in the field of forensic science. We love to write scientific articles which have been published on various international and national platforms. So thank you, sir, for joining with us. Now I request Ms. Nandi to please introduce Eugenio D'Orio, sir, to our respective viewers. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, sir, for joining with us. Eugenio D'Orio, sir, has completed his master's in forensic biology and he is the general director of the Bioforensic Research Center, which is a private Italian institute which performs research in the field of forensic biology in partnership with the University of Naples and different international forensic organizations and universities. From 2016, he is the consultant for the Italian Ministry of Justice about the forensic DNA evidence. Also from 2016, he is a teacher at the specializing course Diagnostic and Forensic Genetics offered by the University of Naples. He is a former researcher at the Copenhagen University and the former adjunctive professor of forensic biology at the University of Milan Unised. He has more than 100 publications on several journals ranging from Italian to international. He has also served as a consultant for the major Italian homicide cases such as Strage di Erba, Elena Ceste's homicide, etc. Sir, after going through your bio, I can very well understand that with how much sincereness and dedication you must have performed your works. Now I would like to request Prashant to begin with our interview round.
Thank you, Nandini, and once again, thank you, sir, for connecting with us. So, sir, shall we start with the interview?
It's my pleasure to stay here with you guys, and thanks a lot for this invitation, because I think that I strongly believe in not is the cooperation, but also the importance and relevance to speak with each other, no matter where we are from, exactly is our educational background, because the first good thing in science is the proper communication. And I really appreciate this initiative of Forensic Corner, because this can provide a platform, or a corner as you call it, where the people can speak with themselves, exchanging different kind of points that can be useful for all, but also especially to the students, that they of course are like to try to find some models or some already experience already done useful for their career. So it's my pleasure.
Thank you so much, sir.
And sir, now I'll begin with my first question, sir. Sir, as for your experience, what inspired you to choose forensic science?
Forensic science, what was my inspiration is pretty nice question about this point. I remember when I was student university and my second year of biology class, my bachelor degree in biology, I remember that at that time, it was 2006-2007 more or less, so like 14 years ago almost, and with my colleagues we were talking about which could be our perspective after this graduation biology, and many of my colleagues they play this way, this question. We would like to be part of the healthcare system. Others say we would like to be nutritional specialists, and I was strange about that point, because they say, hey guys, normally I totally like the new application of the biology in different kinds in a very early stage. So I say, guys, I think all the way of the forensic science, so biology as a service of the forensic science, as a service of the justice system, because the judge, the investigators, the prosecutors will probably in the future will need more and more of the help of the scientists, because it was pretty clear that the system at the time was in changing. So I say, guys, probably our technology can be very useful in the forensic science. And yeah, it's not common, because lots of my colleagues at that time asked me, so you want to be a policeman? And I replied, I don't want to be a policeman. I want to be a scientist that works for the justice system. Then I don't know if I will be a policeman or not. I had my goal, my aims very clearly about I want to use my scientific knowledge in order to help the justice system, to help the investigation, to help the social system in Italy. And this was quite strange, because now in Italy it started. Maybe I will describe later about this point, the forensic science in Italy, just for let you understand a bit of how the forensic science system works in Italy right now. But of course at that time it was almost quite strange, not impossible, but quite strange to think that one biologist can apply his or her knowledge in the forensic science. And for me, it was a bet. In fact, I love to describe my ideas like a bet, because it was a new field of application of the biology. It was a field where it was very uncertain in order to get a job, etc. So it was much more safe for me and for my colleagues to think to get a job in a system that already exists, as for example the healthcare system, okay, or the environmental system. But something that I always love is to try to see new frontiers and new chapters about the application of these technologies and about this. And that's why I chose the forensic science. I remember when I finished my master's degree in biology, over there I was a biologist. Okay, fine. Now I need a master, I need a plus specialization. And of course, I see now is the time that I will study deeply forensic science, and I will go straight ahead for this way. That is exactly what I did at the time. Of course, it was not my only choice. I had kind of different choices and ideas, topics that I was talking about, because of course the question when you're a student is am I doing right with these ideas? If I follow this street, this way, I will be able in the future to get a job, a goal, or it will be something that will not work. Of course, at the time, I had not the answer. So, guys, if you feel uncertain, it's quite normal. But if you are strongly confident in the real application, the application of the knowledge that you are specialist, that you are studying, and you really think that this can help the field, in this case, the forensic science, so, guys, straight ahead for that way, and never give up, as we say.
Yes, that is definitely, I like your way of thinking, that is definitely, I think that we all students should learn from you, that we should have a mindset that we should always trust our skills. We should trust our skills, what we have learned, we should trust our teachers, we should trust our colleagues, so that we can expand our career. So that's really fun.
Thanks. And sir, it's really very important to keep on going and going, never stopping. That's very important, right?
And never stopping, and especially you have to make this preliminary evaluation. Okay, you like a topic, you like a kind of technology, but you have to be vigilant. You have to think which ones can be the benefits of the application of this new technology to this field, in this case the forensic field. There are some benefits, is possible, or I just lost my time? First of all, you have to make a great plan, because this is something that I learned when I was in Copenhagen as a researcher. Because I studied in Italy, at the University of Naples, my bachelor and my master's degree. Then I moved abroad, and for all the students, I totally suggest, guys, if you can do an international experience, please do it, because there are only benefits for you. Benefits from from your social life, because you will be in a different city, in a different country, where you don't know anyone at all. Probably you will speak another language. You will learn how to survive and how to live in a different context that is not comfortable for you at all. So, personal benefits, first of all, and second, of course not second importance, is the fact that you can go to work or study with convinced that you will study the same things, the same topics, but probably you will have a totally different view and perception and organization about study, about thesis, about experimental works, etc. As my personal experience, I learned a lot from my experience in Copenhagen, because over there, and I'm very thankful to my colleagues at the Department of Forensic Science in Copenhagen, they teach me how to plan properly a project, how to focus properly on one rule at a time in order to avoid, to make confusion, because when you have big ideas and good ideas, you have to be very careful about the management. You can have the best idea, but you can be not the best in the planning. So what happens in this case? That probably something you're doing bad. You have to be the good ideas, or at least you have to be able to... you must have the ideas. Then you must to plan it properly. Separate, no matter, no worry if the planification, that is something that you do outside of the laboratories, takes a long time. Because as much accurately and specific is a planning preparation, especially in the research field, as much stronger will be the data of the research that you are going to get. This is the thing that I learned from Denmark, from my experience in Denmark. I was there 2 years, I spent 2 years of my time and last research there. In Italy, unfortunately, I can give you this practical example. In Italy, when we plan a research, okay, normally we are planning for like 1 day to 1 week. In Denmark, I planned my research in 1 month. That's a quite big difference, guys. And in fact, my colleagues here in Napoli asked me, Eugenio, why are you planning the research project for 1 month long? Isn't that too much? According to Italian useful, yes, it's too much, but according to international standard, it's not too much, it's the right time. In fact, I was able to make a very precise plan, and at the end of my work, after 2 years there, I was able to get very precise results that lead me to give different publications about my research topic. So, this is something that I totally suggest to students. I hope that, of course, I know that not all students can do this experience because to go abroad, go to study and live abroad, it costs. And I know. I hope that the grants will support the students. Otherwise, I hope that the students will be very, very strongly motivated that they just go there and fight and maybe they find a student job in order to stay there. But guys, try to find a way for doing this experience. No matter if 1 year, 3 years, or 6 months, but if you do this experience, you will be a richer person in both in all the ways possible.
Yes, sir. That is definitely true. Sir, your energy can definitely is motivating us, and definitely that is really, really inspiring.
Yes, sir.
Sir, my next question is, how did you plan to open your own private laboratory? Like, how did that thought came and how this thing worked? How did this happen?
Yeah, okay, this is another of my plans. I started I read the first class when I told you I choose the forensic science field, and for me it was a bet. And this one is my second bet to open the center. Why I did this? First of all, when I back from Copenhagen, and it was late 2017, so I back in Italy in January 2018. After 2 years of research experience, I was a researcher, I read data. Here I work for the Ministry of Justice, I work for the judge, I work for representatives, and I work also for lawyer in courtroom. And so normally I do my full biological analysis, but I also go in courtroom to make an expert testimony in courtroom, etc. I think that I noticed that when I back here that I was totally absorbed from the justice system. I had no more time for all my research. Because of course when you work on criminal cases, it's a full-time job, guys. Because they require the loss of attention, the amount of the matter, so the documentation that we have to check is quite big. So it was problematic for me to keep on with my research. But I tried at the time with my colleagues, the professor Nino Corano at the University of Naples, he is the director of the specializing course where I teach, Diagnostic and Forensic Genetics. Fine, it's like a third level degree master, specifically in the forensic community field. It's okay, it's just a course for students. But I say, we have not any kind of research activities that is going on at the University of Napoli in this field, so in the forensic biology field. I asked my colleague, Mimmo, can we try to reuse the data that I got from my Copenhagen experience and start here, ex novo, from the beginning, new research task specifically in the forensic genetics application, because in Napoli there is, in the University of Napoli there are lots of research tasks open, but many of them are related with the human genetics, the medical genetics. They don't involve the forensics. science. For 1 year I worked with him and we tried to fix a good arrangement of grants, because we need the equipment for the laboratory in order to perform these research activities and so on. And unfortunately, Italy anyway is not a richest country at all, if you compare, for example, with the United Kingdom or with Scandinavian countries where I was a student, where I was a researcher there. So unfortunately, it was not possible for the Department of Biology of the University of Napoli to buy any laboratory equipment in order to perform this research. And were not any grants support for the researcher and maybe PhD students. This is another thing that we miss in Italy, the PhD in forensic science or in forensic biology. This is strange also for me, because I don't have, for example, the PhD, because in Italy, right now, in 2020, there is not existing PhD on forensic science or forensic biology. I skip it directly to the researcher or to the teacher in this field, but this is quite strange, because normal the proposed way is master, bachelor degree, master degree, PhD, postdoc, then you begin research and teacher, and then you will be teacher. The lack of a PhD here, but my experience in research internationally in the University of Copenhagen, I don't know why exactly, but it happened, allowed me to be a teacher, an associated teacher at the university, because I got this international experience that in Italy we don't have yet. I'm strongly still fighting in order to try to develop some PhD programs, because this is possibly it's something that we miss here, but it's something that exists in almost all other countries. Why in Italy it does not exist yet? Same thing. I know that you in India, for you, exist a bachelor degree and master degree in forensic science, right? In Italy, it doesn't exist yet. And it's quite strange. In fact, this explains why I am graduated as a biologist, and then I made a specialization in the forensic science. But I remain a biologist. So I can work in forensic science, but only for everything that involves the DNA, genetics, and of course the biological traits. In fact, one of my research projects, the biggest one that I worked on and one I have many publications on, is the field of technology and validation of new protocols in order to find, to detect and document the latent biological stain on a crime scene or on different kind of items that normally the police operators collected from the crime scene and take to the laboratory in order to analyze. So I am specialized on this topic. Anyway, for beginning to your question, it was impossible to continue my work, my research work, totally linked with the University of Napoli. Here the university is public, okay? So I was working a lot in criminal investigation. Of course, I earned some money from this work, and I decided to invest part of this money in order to create, to take in Italy, to put in Italy what we were not able to set up with the public university. So I opened this bioforensics research center. I bought the equipment. I also make lots of international cooperation also with the companies that produce this kind of instrumentation, and they want them their very high performance, accuracy, etc. So we have different kind of agreement, and actually, okay, I know this is the COVID years, so of course it's quite slowly the situation now, because we had unfortunately a long break, but we are starting fortunately now. And thanks to this idea of my ADS, I was able to open this research center. The research center is in partnership with the University of Napoli, with the University of Perugia, and also with other universities in America, in New Jersey exactly, and we are also talking with other universities in Asia. Because which one is the goal? The goal is to try to develop a memorandum of understanding that can lead us to make program, research program, run together, research program. So I can give you these pieces, you can give me these pieces, we can put on the pieces and we can get best results. So I am trying to work in like this. And actually we just started the works in the field of the detection of the latent evidence. We are working on these programs. And of course, I always, because here now we have COVID restrictions, so now I am not able to have more than 5 persons in my lab because of the social distancing. Normally, in normal time, I can have also 10 persons in my laboratory. So hopefully this time will pass soon, so I will be very also happy to develop partnership with different universities and also give the possibility for the students that want to do thesis abroad or a trainership abroad, then we can take the agreement. I will be very happy to give this possibility because it was something that for me was essential, and I totally think that now it's my time to appreciate this opinion. So this is why your question.
Yes, that's really I can just imagine. So that's the ideas you have filled with you, that the ideas you, like the ideas which came inside your head, you really executed them so well that you can actually structure it, give a structure to it. That's really amazing.
Yeah, I'm trying. It's a long way. It's a quite long way, but this is a thing that all the guys, all the students must know in advance. Guys, to build a position, a professional position, or project, or career, is something that requires time. So please, don't just look until your nose. Look in front of your way. So long-term plans are always the best. So don't be blind, go straight. Okay, just not repeat. Yes, sir.
So we would definitely like to come up to Italy for your lab and all to gain the experience, sir.
Yeah, we'll definitely will try our best if we get an opportunity.
Yes, sir.
For me, it will be a pleasure, guys. It's something that we can do, but there is also the bureaucratic part that we have to properly fix. So if the university where you're from, is open to develop this kind of partnership totally for the interest of the student, in order that the students will get benefits, we can of course speak and set up the situation properly. It's something that I strongly believe in, because I am one of the international son. So I consider me an international son because it's quite important. If I never went to Denmark, probably I was never able to build all this system here. But step by step.
Definitely, sir.
So my next question is, you have already described this, that you pursued you studied biology and then you started a career in forensic science. But what was that interest that brought you into the field of biology and then it?
Of course, as I told you, I am graduated in biology, so I cannot look to other research tasks. I like, for example, also the fingerprint investigation, the medical exam, the firearms investigation. Quite nice. I love to speak with my colleagues that are specialists in this field, but for my specific background, I can apply to forensic science only looking at biological and genetics application. And in order to reply to this question, I also take a consideration. Normally, it seems that in the forensic science application of the biology, everything must be focused on the DNA. Because if you find a DNA profile on a crime scene, you will probably solve the crime. But this is true, but this is not true until the end. I try to explain better. DNA is not everything. DNA is quite useful, but the judge cannot found their opinions only on the DNA. They need order. They need more scientific information. This information can be from different tasks of the forensic science, but they can also come from different sections of the forensic biology, because never forget that the DNA is only the last step of a very big way. So one of the things that we have to consider, and I was able to show and the most to my ex-colleagues in Copenhagen, but also to my colleagues here in Italy working in the criminal investigation, is this fact. We have very strong and accurate technology for the DNA analysis. Fine. But sometimes when we make analysis, when we make investigation, for example, this shirt, okay, right in my labs, please analyze this shirt and tell me if there are any DNA profile on it. Okay. Now my shirt is supposed to be green. So normally the operators don't see any stains and with their eyes. So how can exactly they collect? This is a big problem, guys. Because if you don't look to one stage, probably biology, it's something completely different. So in this case, I think the screening, the preliminary screening, thanks to the technology for the stain evaluation, alternative light source, UV lamps, wood lamps, etc., or microscopy as well, hyperspectral camera, kind of this technology, for me, if you screen the items, especially the one where you don't see any biological evidence, it's basically. Otherwise, you will risk to obtain, if you don't make this preliminary research of the items, you will go in two different ways. One is a not full DNA profiling on the items under investigation. This means no help for the investigation. Another way is there is the DNA of the items, but it's an issue and we are not able to understand and to identify the contributors, because this is something that is quite common. Why happens this? Because when they don't see any spots, any stains, they just perform a swab like this, so randomly, okay? Quite a specific. It can happen that two or more different biological stains can be collected by the same tool. So the result the genetic residue will be a mixture. But it was not a mixture in the original. It became a mixture because we were not able to perform a very accurate screening of the items. So that's why I totally trust in the fact that the biology, the forensic biology, is something of essential and is not less important than forensic DNA investigation. These two fields, because these are two fields, consequently, first one, second the DNA, they are totally strictly connected and there is not one more important than the other. If you have a good first spot, you can have a very good second spot. But if your first system is low, of course the genetic analysis can be low level, not upgrade. So unfortunately now all the attention of the scientific community, size roughly 15 years, is totally focused on the DNA, just DNA. No, DNA is not the only question. We need also to study and to work on the validity of this new technology in order to perform best DNA for the analysis. And this is an approach that is not quite representative, actually, in the scientific community. Let's see, because I totally work on this and I totally trust in what I'm doing. Let's see what will happen in a few years, because, long term.
Yes, sir, that is definitely true, sir. Sir, now I request Ms. Nandini, please continue with the remaining questions.
Okay. Thank you, Prashant. How would you describe forensic science work in Italy, sir?
Forensic science work in Italy is, first of all, you can divide in two parts the forensic science work. First is if you are a police operator. In Italy we have Polizia di Stato and Carabinieri, two different police systems, and you will work in that case for those sectors. Of course, with your background, you can apply for this position, and unfortunately, there are no many positions available because these are technical rules in the police. So there are not many positions available, but this is a way. If you apply and you win this application, you will be the police officers, and of course you work for prosecutors. You will have a salary from the Ministry of the Interior or Ministry of Defense, it depends, and you can do your work only for the prosecutors, no other person. Instead, and this is not my position, and this is there are positions like mine, for example, when you are a free operator, because I am, with my graduation, with my size, with my knowledge, with my resume, with my curriculum, I was able to apply for the expert list of the control. So, the expert of the judges. I made this application in 2015, and in 2016 I was accepted. And since that time I am on that list. This does not mean that I have a fixed salary for the Ministry of Justice, but this means that I am on this special list, this kind of white list, and when the judge, or also sometimes lawyers, because they have to do the defense, and because I work in a criminal case, so I don't work in the civil case, I work in a criminal case, they also need a consultant in order to defend properly the rights of their customer. So in this case, you can be called for your expertise by judges and by the lawyers. This is what I'm doing exactly. Just a thing that I have to be precise on. In the same case, If we are called from the judge, we cannot work also for one of the for the defense. Otherwise, it's a conflict of interest, of course. And if a private customer, such as a lawyer or a private customer, call us for our expertise, if the client, if the customer is private, we can also decide to don't take the case. We can also deny the case. We don't want to work in. We have this possibility. Instead, if a judge asks me my work on a case, I can't say no to the judge, except if I am involved in a case such as suspicious or people under investigation, etc. Or I am familiar with victim or with people under investigation, or because I already worked for a defendant. And this is quite unfrequently, quite rare, this condition. So all the colleagues and the students say, so at least in Italian, because this is the Italian system, they, when they are on the white list for the judge, it's called the list of 80, and the judge will call you, you have to ask, you can never say no to the judge, otherwise you will be fired.
So there are definitely that is so strict, so much strict laws are there, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I don't know exactly what's in the system in India. I don't know exactly about the rule in America because I have colleagues there. I have been also there in university for different corporations, etc. They have a system similar to Italian one, and the same thing we can we share with the United Kingdom or with the Netherlands. We have a similar approach on this point. But for example, in Denmark, in Copenhagen, where I was, it's different. The consultant for the private part, such the people under investigation, they are not able to have any consultant. So it's different. This depends by the whole system.
So in India, like you asked, like, as students, we have not have actual experience in the crime thing, but still, like, we have seen thoughts, but like the way the things are going on here. We have basically a student who is a student either from biology, physics, or chemistry, or even from forensic science, a graduate and then a master's degree. Starts applies to a lab, and they can go to a lab, and they can start with their career there. Or otherwise, what they do is they can collaborate with the police officers, and they can help the police officer. But when it comes to the work of a forensic scientist, it depends on the police and the requirement. Because here in India, forensic scientist is basically summoned. When it's required, they are called upon, otherwise they will go to every crime.
Yes,
sir. Yeah, this is what I'm saying. Just we cannot have, except for very great exceptions, normally we will not. We work with, but we don't collaborate. We can work with them, with the policemen, in order to improve the security decision, but we will be never a part of the policy system. Instead, we can be the expert of the judge. So what happens? The police make the investigation, and me and my colleagues that are the judge expert, we have the room to check that everything has been made in the perfect respect of the scientific protocols. If this by policy, of course, if this happens, we certify the high quality of what happens. If this doesn't happen, we have to certify that this is, has been not happened, and we have to explain why this is not happened. And of course, then the judge will take their own decisions.
But even in India, there is one more thing I would like to add on. Like here, there are three categories of the way forensic science work happens. Like first is the regional level. At the regional level, we are covering small cities and towns. But when it comes to the state level, the entire state is to be covered. And then there is a authority that is basically basically handles the high profile cases, like which are very important for the national security or something of national importance. That we call as the cases that the central authority handles. And then we have a lot of private labs, private consultancy. So that is a bit, I think it's kind of similar, but they are still a bit different.
Yeah, it's not that different, and it's interesting also the approach of the three different layers, but it's also very interesting the fact that there are many, as you say just now, private laboratories that are going to open in order to offer their service to private, but also for the public system, for the forensic investigation. In Italy, there are very few private, probably my center by forensics is the only center in Italy that is specialized on forensic biology, because of course this is a research center, but if a judge will ask me to perform specific investigation that involve my experience and my knowledge here, I will be here. But this is the only center where you can do this. Otherwise, because the labs of the police are closed for nature, you cannot enter there. I can enter there when I am a consultant or judge of crime, and because I am mandatory and I can do there and have the access. Otherwise, I am not able to have this access. Because it's strictly regulated. But let's see what I think is very interesting the approach of the system that you can have in, and probably this can lead to a very big growth, because I think the forensic science system, including not just biology, but including all the different forensic disciplines, is something that can have a very important also financial boom. So keep on this, and if there are laboratories, private ones, that they are opening, so pretty good. Because this is the sign that also the interest, but also the marketing is moving on. And be ready for getting this opportunity, guys, especially you that are still students.
Thank you so much, sir. So moving on to the next
Even forensic science has evolved a lot. You can see how many virtual events have happened in forensic science, and a lot of promotion to the field of forensic science has been exposed.
About the promotion of forensic science, I have some reserve, because sometimes I think that there is kind of promotion that is self-misleading, because forensic science, okay, the one that we normally study in the university, in the academics, in the academicians, is not a CSI fiction. It's something quite different. But unfortunately, there are persons that make a big confusion about this part. We need to explain this. Okay, I've been also to the United Kingdom. Over there, I got some specializing course. I am a certified crime scene investigator, so I am a certified CSI. Fine, but what I'm doing? I go to crime scene, go to lab, go to courtroom, and go to arrest the victim. No, it's not. That is fiction. The real life is just a person, a student, a professional that has a very strong experience and knowledge and is adult and is allowed to go to some crime scene or to some laboratories in order to not to find the guilty. The goal is not to find the guilty, but the goal is to provide judges, because I think that forensic scientists must work for the justice, for the judges, and we have to serve them, providing all the scientific information as possible. If something is not probably quite clearly or body not accurate, we never, ever have to accuse someone. Otherwise, we probably will start a judicial thing. And this can be dramatic, because this can mean the misleading of the science. So we have to be very careful about this. The forensic scientists are a professional that works for serving the justice system. We are not a justiciary person. We don't judge, we don't want to judge anyone, we just work for serve the justice system through a scientific way, no more than this. So if you find some promotion with a different terms, if the terms are different, don't trust in it. Scientific system is something totally different. It's in Italy, we have this problem quite strongly. And this is probably one of my big enemies sometimes. Sometimes also to my student, I have to explain, hey guys, reset your mind. This, what we are going to do, is not what you are going to see on television. It's different. But sometimes, for the restart, this think, this way to think the world, the profession, it's quite different. It's quite difficult. But of course, we must to work from now to future in order to communicate the right message. Forensic science is not something for find the guilty. Forensic science is something for serve the justice. That's it. So be careful to the strongly aggressive promotion of forensic science. Some of them are misleading.
Yes, we'll keep that in mind.
Thank you so much, sir. Sir, moving on to the next question. What is the best thing that you like about this field?
I can make a very long piece. No, the best thing that that I like is that doing this work, especially working in the research, such as also to work in criminal cases, is the fact that we have always to be open with mind, open with point of view, and we never, there is not a protocol sometimes for the right thing, but for the things in the best. But we have to, first of all, to strongly understand that our work can make a difference. So the levels, the adrenalines, the level of adrenalines of each other can be very, very high, but they must be, because sometimes the work of the forensic science, when it's doing correctly, can make a difference. We have to be confident about this point, that if we work properly, following all protocols, respecting all the rules, we in potential can make a difference. Difference can be, solving the case, can be demonstrating that the people that has been convicted is not guilty, to help the family that lost one of the family members, etc. We have to be strongly focused on this. Our work can make a difference. We have to do our work in the best way as possible. That is what I totally love of my words. It's impossible to get annoyed if you approach it this way.
Definitely, sir. Sir, moving on to the next question. What were the obstacles that were faced by you while pursuing forensic science as a career?
Of course, the start. Of course, the first time when I finished my my master's degree, but also when I finished my specializing course of forensic biology, the big problem it was that I was not a police officer, so I had not the salary, the fixed salary at the end of the month, but I had to get in a system, the judiciary, the forensic science, in order to get my my money, my salary, as you want to call it. Of course, the start is the much more difficult part. But I think, especially in that time, you have to be very, very strong, never give up, especially in that time, because to study is an hard work. But when you finish to be a student, and you will have to begin a worker, an operator, a profession, it can be quite difficult, probably more difficult. I don't want to put you down, you have to be up. Totally up, but you have to consider this, that in order to get in a new system, you also have to introduce yourself to the right person. Because, okay, who are your stakeholders in this case, if you work as a client? The judge, the prosecutors, and the lawyers. So you have to let you know in a professional way from judge, prosecutors, and lawyers. There is not a protocol for doing this. You just have to work on it. Because who can give you work? Who can give you work when you can earn money for your life and you can feel satisfied as well? This profession, judge, lawyer, prosecutor. Fine. Try to find the best way in order to be professionally and scientifically in touch with this person. And continue, because you will never get result in 1 month, or in 3 months, or in 6 months. This is a thing that required years. I remember at the start it was quite hard also for me, but in more or less 2 years, if you are doing the right steps, everything will change. And you will find in few times, if now I am only 32 years old, I'm pretty young also for the Italian consultant, because all my colleagues here have the average of 60 years old. So probably I am the youngest one here that I am doing this job. What I did, I just strongly focused on to work on the networking, in the professional networking. Thanks to this professional networking, it was possible for me to get consultant also in the minor case in Italy that you before cited. So, and when you get in the system, if you are very good on your first and second case, you will continue to work much more and much more always. But you have to be very good. So, especially when you got the first job, be very, very clear.
Definitely, sir. It's very important to be connected with the people so that you don't know that it's a very small world who, like, when you want someone, like, the needs, right, sir?
So, like the way we are all getting connected to today, just from a point of an interview, but still we are getting to communicate, we are networking and we are sharing ideas, we are having opinions and a lot of things which can help. Like for us, like you are an experience and we are right now the student phase. So these all things are definitely at the building blocks that can help us climb up. So thank you, sir, for such an insight.
My pleasure and good luck to you guys, to you and to all your colleagues. And guys, my opinion, you are doing a very great job, because when I was a student, I had not this idea to develop a forensic corner. No, it's good. It's quite good, because you are still students, but you are already developing the good network. So keep on, guys.
Thank you so much, sir. Sir, shall we move on?
Tell me, sorry.
Okay, yeah, sir, we have next question. That's, sir, yeah. How can we all collaboratively create awareness about the field of forensics?
Guys, collaboration for how can create awareness collaboratively? New ideas. if you put on the tables new ideas, if you have the ideas and you have the colleagues, especially the international colleagues, because you must try this, that's the first step. If you speak with colleagues from, I don't know, from the Kuwait, from the Middle East, or from Africa, or from Australia, and you ask, hey, we do this kind of analysis, for example, we collect evidence here, like this kind of work, you know, we have this result. Which one is your approach? You have a different approach? You use our same approach, or which one are the results that you are able to get? If you plan this also small, because these are small things, small projects, but if you plan some small project like this, and doing the comparison, and you can compare methodologies and approach from different students, from different professionals, from different institutions worldwide, of course that's the best way. Then maybe from a small study, small ideas like this, maybe can develop, can begin, can be done, you can build a new big project, and maybe this project can be, of course we hope, supported by grants. This can be a very great idea. So, important for this is always to learn new things. Of course, you have always to keep you up to date on technology, on methodology, on protocols, but you always have, you don't have to study, and stop. You have to get you open, your mind open, sorry. Your mind has always to be open. Okay. With this new technology, we are able to arrive here. How can I raise from here to here? You have always continued asking me this, and you have always tried to find a solution. This can be the best for also competition, you know.
Yeah.
Yes, sir, that is true.
So, sir, we would like to ask with the last question. Sir, would you like to give us some insights about the cases such as Strange di Erba and Elena's Ceste homicide cases?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, yeah, sir.
So because we have provided the expert opinion on that so that we can get some idea on how this experience was.
Yes, yeah, sir.
How was your experience?
Okay, so these are the Strage di Erba. It's a pluri-homicide case happened in North Italy in 2006. Five people were hacked to death by unknown people, killed in the same way, including a child of 2 years old. They were killed with a knife here on the jugular. That five persons killed in the same way. Then, in this small apartment, the perpetrator gives fire on. So that crime scene became a fire scene. And it was dramatic because lots of evidence were lost because of the fire. Then, investigation, the traditional investigation, because unfortunately in that case the scientific investigation at that time, so 14 years ago, don't provide big result or important result in order to indicate to the prosecutor who can be the perpetrator. By the traditional investigation, the prosecutors identify 2 persons, neighbors. And they were both arrested, they were husband and wife, and they have been sentenced lifelong for this homicide. But based on a declaration of one of the 5 persons before to die, because when he he get up in hospital, he say, I see a person with a very dark face, or probably something of, in North Italy, they are not tanned like me, they are white, okay, as a color, as an ethical color. The first thing that he declared that it was a person that killed everyone, and it was quite dark of the skin. Of course, it was not the neighbors. After, we don't know what exactly happens, after 6 hours, this person changed his description, and he say it has been the neighbors. But the neighbors is white. It's not black man, or the Middle East color, probably like me. So it was totally confusing, this situation. Anyway, they have been convicted. After 3 years, there are still investigations that we are carrying on. And okay, we have to also take this under consideration. After the homicides and after the fire at the crime scene, the perpetrators leave the apartment not by the central door, the main door, because it was a fire. They had to escape from the balcony at the second floor, 4 meters to the ground. Okay, so the perpetrator convicted, they were 1.50 meters tall and quite large, quite chubby, if you know what I mean. So, not athletic person. Mm. If a person with that physical shape will jump from a balcony on the second floor, he will break a leg. He or she will break a leg. But they were okay. So there is something of strange. It's quite strange that they were able to get off from there and with no any bounds at all. So, something was wrong. And I always, of course, I was the expert for the DNA investigation over there. I checked that there were some biological DNA evidence in the case, but they researched, the operators researched the stains with a methodology of the 1970, so a random research of the evidence. Of course, it was. This leads to no reference. So I explained to the judge, it's not true that we don't have a result, because it's not possible that one person who in that apartment killed 5 people, so burn everything and don't leave one DNA trace. It's impossible. I say it's impossible. It must be some evidence. And the fact is that with all technology and old methodology that have been used, we were not able to detect that evidence because they were covered by the victim's blood. But this doesn't mean that the evidence of the offenders are not there. We have to try to reanalyze the items with a new methodology. Probably, if we will be able to do this, we will find the DNA, at least in a statistical way. Now we have more chance to get a full DNA profile that can lead to some scientific information. Then, if you find the DNA of the neighbors, okay, case closed. But if you don't find a DNA of the neighbors, but you will find the DNA of another person, maybe it's time to reopen this case. And now we are still working on this, because I am not able to go there, take the items and make the real investigation. I can do this, but the judge needs to approve these records. Some judge approved it, some judge rejected it. So it's a controversy from the territorial courtroom with the Supreme Courtroom in Italy. So if they will not solve this point, we cannot access to that items. So this is what is going on now. I don't know what will happen from a scientific way, because I am a scientist, a forensic scientist. I say it's totally fundamental that we must be able to get data items, and we must to reanalyze them with the new technology. Then let's see the result. But at least we have to do this. 5 people have been killed, 2 persons are actually sentenced lifelong. They declare themselves innocent from the beginning. We must to be more specific. So this is a Strage di Erba case. Something is about.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you. I think, and we are very, very extremely sorry that we took a lot of time of yours today.
Yes, sir.
Because I think it was expected to be ending soon, but I think the time went on unexpectedly long.
No problem. It has been a great pleasure for me, and I really hope that this time together can be open for you. For me, because also for me, it's important to do this. For you, guys, but also for all the students that will watch this video.
Yes.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for your time, and thank you for being with the Forensic Corner, and thank you for inspiring us. And definitely, the viewers who will be viewing this interview, they will be definitely inspired, and they will definitely start to gain some resourceful insight. So thank you so much, sir.
Thanks so much, Forensic Corner, and Prashant and Ami for inviting me.
Yes. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you so much, sir, for accepting.
Yes, sir. Bye, sir.
Bye. Take care, sir. Stay safe. So, guys, this was one of our wonderful interview series with Eugenio, sir. And subscribe to our YouTube channel to stay updated with more of such coming interviews. And stay safe. Good luck. Keep growing and stay with the Forensic Corner. Bye-bye.